And I frankly was shocked at this statistic. More than half of Chicagoans, renters and homeowners, are paying more than the federal government sees as an amount of money where they can pay for other life necessities. It's called being cost burdened by your housing. More than half of Chicagoans. Now I know we say, oh, San Francisco or New York, maybe, but here in Chicago, it's really, really bad. People are in eviction, foreclosure, in really poor quality housing, and on the streets. And some are doubled up and tripled up. And yet, we haven't had much visibility in the press. Unfortunately, when we had the 2008 crisis, instead of focusing on the people who were really struggling, I kept reading articles of all those bad people who took out mortgages that they couldn't afford. Or those bad banks who were giving out bad mortgages, which frankly, I'm very glad they focused on. But no one has focused very much, certainly at that time and certainly since, on this ongoing housing crisis that we have. Now figure, if you have to pay half of your income on your rent, well, if you're earning $100,000 a year, maybe it's not so terrible, although you still have to pay transportation and healthcare and taxes and so on. But think about a minimum wage worker, even when they're earning $12 an hour. What the hell do they have left? They have almost nothing left to even eat. And if we work our way up, even to people earning the median income, which is 50 some odd thousand, Janet, help me, do you know the stat?
47.
Thanks,
Kevin. 47, then you take some taxes off, right? And if you're severely cost burdened, it's 50%. If not, it's 30, and you take that off. And you figure transportation costs of owning a car, paying for the gasoline, paying for the insurance so you can get to work, and so on. Again, even if your median income and earning what we think of as a decent living wage, you're still in deep water, especially given the Chicago rents and the cost of mortgages and the cost of housing, which is really high. So that's what we're going to talk about tonight from these folks' perspective, as well as some solutions.
Good evening, my name is James Rudyk, and I'm the executive director of the Northwest Side Housing Center. The Northwest Side Housing Center is a HUD-certified nonprofit organization here in Chicago. And we provide free foreclosure prevention counseling to homeowners. And we also now provide rental counseling to renters. And we help homeowners that are potential homeowners that are looking to buy a home for the first time prepare for home ownership. And we're located on Diversity and Laramie in the Belmont Cragen neighborhood. So a little bit of background. So Roberta asked us, what do we see as one of the greatest challenges of the housing crisis? And what are organizations doing about it? So. The two words that come to mind for me are what I call foreclosure fatigue, and not only for the alliteration, but for the fact that this has been going on for a long time, and unfortunately, in popular media and in mainstream society, it seems that there's a lack of focus on foreclosure and housing-related issues, whether that's at the legislative level, in the media, even organizationally, funding. If you look at government funding for HUD and other programs has been significantly cut over the last several years. The media stopped picking up stories. It's no longer news when a homeowner loses their home or a bank gets a fine or a settlement came down for millions and millions of dollars. And so Illinois still remains in the top five states in terms of foreclosure filings. And we know that Chicago leads Illinois. And so what that tells us is there's still a foreclosure crisis. And we try and say that wherever we go. As an organization, and so one of the things is foreclosures have spread. So where we used to have foreclosures in a very specific, concentrated neighborhood, they've spread throughout the suburbs, cities, different community areas, so it may look different for folks, and it may take longer, and it may be different populations that are in foreclosure, but it's still there. Some of the assistance at the state level is no longer there. So there was a program called the Hardest Hit Fund through the state of Illinois that helped unemployed or underemployed homeowners pay their mortgage. That program has ceased to exist. And all those homeowners, the thousands that has received assistance, are now without employment, had their mortgage paid, but no longer are receiving assistance, and now are coming back for help a second time. Interest rates on HAMP, so HAMP is the federal government loan modification program, are starting to adjust. So there were adjustable rate mortgages, so they brought homeowners' interest rates down to 2%, 3%, they're climbing. So for a homeowner that's underemployed or already cost burdened, as Roberta said, going from 2 to 4% on your interest rate, you don't have that extra $200-$400 a month to pay. So we're finding that folks are coming back to us for a second or third time. And so my words are foreclosure fatigue. And what we're doing is we're fighting the good fight as an organization. We've made a commitment to housing, and we continue that commitment. We continue to find funding. We continue to go to private foundations, some of which are here tonight, for support. When the government money's not there, we have a really committed board of directors, some of which are here again tonight, and they're committed to finding the funding for us. So we're continuing to be on the ground and do the work.
The Chicago Rehab Network, which I'm a part of, I happen to be the director, is 37 years in the space of community development and empowerment without displacement. That's the mission that operates. We're exclusively run by other nonprofit organizations like James. So it's a very unique place. And the whole focus is, how do we build community? How do we build with who lives in our neighborhoods today? Because what we are constituted by is what's called community development corporations. These are mission-based organizations that are committed to making sure there's a place for everyone. The agenda that matters is an equity agenda, that we ask the question, who's being served by these policies? The Rehab Network does not touch real estate itself, but we do training, educational activities, forums, so people can understand. There's some very serious programs. In the past, we've partnered with my colleague Janet on, to my left here at Voorhees, and with the College of Urban Planning, and it was a year-long program of building capacity for the, we think of it's for the nonprofits, but if you know who's gone through our programs, it's actually people across the whole field. So the managing director of Housing for the City of Chicago, Lawrence Grisham, is a graduate of the Chicago Rehab Network, as is the past mayor candidate, Chuy Garcia, as is Katrina Van Valkenburg, who's the head of supportive housing today, right? And that's the thing to be thinking about. A member of ours, Mark Angelini from Mercy Housing, had a beautiful write-up in Cranes about the foolish, penny-wise, pound-foolish strategy going on about cutting services in terms of supportive housing. What we think about at the Rehab Network is we have to think across the continuum. And what we launched over a decade ago was an initiative called Valuing Affordability. And if you remember, we had the culture wars perking up at this time, and there's a lot of questions about what are the values that matter in American society. So we intentionally wanted to make sure we come back to, if you know our history, one of the key values about America was always making sure there was affordable housing, right? We, so much so that you can go to a generation, not just a generation, two centuries ago, we were giving people land, the Homestead Act, please come, right? So you can trace all this effort to make sure that we have a place for people. The Housing Act of 1949 that wrote paralleled with the GI Bill was a whole effort to make sure that there was intentionality about making sure we grow the housing stock, because it was an asset, right? I grew up with the notion of, if you stayed in housing long enough, it would become a place that you could rely on. As James is pointing out, and others will, Frank and others, and Charles, we don't have that anymore. That doesn't exist. So what we see is, for instance, with our relationship with Voorhees, we do a lot of analysis. So coming back so you understand who we are, we do analysis, reports, and forums about the state of affairs. We are also very much involved with providing testimony and reports to our elected officials and policymakers. The next piece that we're doing is the capacity building for people and training so that we have a strong field. What's the leadership? How do people know how to do this? It's not easy. But what we want is for people to do it right, because it's a public-private partnership, there's a lot of money on the line to make sure there's housing that's affordable. And the third part of that is, well, what's this all about with affordable? Well, we recognize it's a government standard, 30% of your income, as Roberta mentioned, right? That's the standard. So in Chicago, what we've seen is in 1980, to give you a course, 25% of Chicagoans in 1990 were cost burdened. One out of four were spending more than 30% to afford their housing in 1990. What is it by 2010? Somebody give me a number. 50%. Reverend Hood, always on the number. So we've doubled that. Half of us in Chicago are paying too much. And when that happens, we start to lose the ability for daycare support, for transportation issues, for savings, for health, and all this stuff. And that's what we launched when I mentioned valuing affordability, is to wrap up, is how you value affordability is to make sure that ultimately, to answer Roberta's second question, is the problem is housing's not a right. It's about housing being a right, right? That's really what we need to get to, is that people have a right to a safe, decent place. That was the 49 Act. Our value affordability that we launched said you have to have the policies and resources, you have to have the leadership, and you have to have the resources to make this all work. We can talk a little bit more about that. The other part that we're very committed to, it's about local communities. It's about places. And that is very contested in America today in all enterprises, and that is we have to have mega enterprises to deal with these issues because it's all about scale. But the real scale, from our experience, for watching how this has transpired in the last 40 years, is what James does out in his neighborhood. That's the scale of council because he knows the people. Same with my members over in Pilsen. They know that we have to get this housing to work for these families, for these seniors. That's what their income is. It's not about, oh, I can make this work and I can just drop it in. And that's the challenge in our societies today, and in Chicago today in particular, where you see some very severe problems. You look around and say, where's the mission-based organization? Where's the nonprofit that's out there saying, I'm committed to this? And if there isn't one there, why not?
Hi, my name is Janet Smith. Two hats I wear, and I'll talk a little bit about both, and they commingle at UIC, where I'm a professor, or associate professor. Just give myself a promotion. Please, someone pay attention. Associate, and I'd like a raise. I work for the state of Illinois. I know. It's been a long day. So I teach urban planning at UIC, been there 18 years, and my area of focus is community development, so that's why I'm nodding my head a lot to what Kevin's talking about. And the other thing I do is I co-direct a research center called the Natalie P. Voorhees Center for Neighborhood and Community Improvement, or for short, the Voorhees Center, because it's a very long name. But it's important to note the name Natalie P. Voorhees and the Voorhees family, which was very committed to neighborhoods, actually. The way Mr. Voorhees and his wife talked about what was going on in Chicago when they were here 35 years ago, or 36 years ago, they both have passed in the last decade. But when they were here in Chicago, they noted that that they saw this growing inequality in the United States, and that we were seeing sort of economic segregation going on, and they were very concerned about it, which is interesting because, as our research shows now, it's even worse than it was in 1970. It's doubled in terms of the extremes, in terms of inequalities. So that's a sort of one of the points I want to make. So in terms of thinking about the challenges and sort of where we're at, the Voorhees Center is very grounded in working with community-based organizations and working with groups like the Chicago Rehab Network. We've been around the same amount of time, 35 years, so 36 years now, and we've been sort of hand in glove, I guess is the way to say it. They're the policy and sort of people doing the stuff on the ground, helping people on the ground, and we're the data wonks, if you will, behind the scenes, offering up information that help people. And so my first thing, I guess I would say, is besides the fatigue that you were talking about, is sort of the lack of awareness. So the data that we put out there is useful and it gets used, and so we produce a lot of information for people to understand the housing problem. So the statistics that Roberta cites, the quiz that we're going to have at the end on data, All of that we crank out, and we've been putting out there since 1983, I think, the fact book, the first fact book. We've been doing an affordable housing fact book. And so it's available on our website. It's very basic, simple, one page per community area. So Chicago has 77 communities. There's a fact page for the city of Chicago. There's fact book, more importantly, there's fact book pages for your alderman's ward. Very important during election. It was out conveniently before the election and used by a lot of people to talk to aldermen, and I think maybe change some of the scene in Chicago in terms of the aldermanic elections. People raising a lot of questions. So we're that data, those data folks that we do that. And I want to say, though, that the awareness that I think is more important besides just the data that I was thinking about coming over here, and I wrote quickly some notes on, is what I call the, you know, the first step is you have to admit you have a problem. And, you know, there was this little window of time, we had this sort of radical, what I call a radical moment in history when we had a housing crisis hit. And it was literally like a window, like a little window opened up. And I remember this sort of, the idea people were having of talks of taking over banks. Like literally, like, you know, that Friday come in and shut down all the banks and nationalize them. Remember that? Yes, I know. Yeah. Sorry, Frank and I go on. Yeah.
Tomorrow, you say?
Yes. Let's go for Friday. It's always, you have to do it on Friday. But no, really, do you remember, I listen to public radio and I'm kind of a junkie for This American Life. And we were all listening attentively to like stories, and we learned about toxic, you know, toxies as they call them, where they were talking about like toxic loans, and we were learning all about things like mortgage swaps, and we were becoming very knowledgeable about the whole mortgage problem. And but it was this larger discussion that was going on about how the way we structured our debt, the way we got into debt, the reason we got into debt, the reason a bubble burst, and all these things. And it's just, it burst. You know, I mean, who was the person who said, don't waste a good crisis? He's mayor now, is he? Yes. But if you remember that, that was this point, right, where we were supposed to, like, look at this as an opportunity to wake up. We had Occupy going on. We had all these people thinking. Occupy brought together people across the spectrum that were not coming together around housing issues. I stood in protest with people who were coming in from the suburbs saying, this isn't right. And where did it go? It's like, as soon as the housing market came back, everyone's like, baby, we're back. And they're like, that shit's behind us. You know, I'm sorry, that's a technical term in on my world. But it's like, no, they're like, it's behind us. We're past, whew, we made it through, and we've forgotten completely about the things that brought us there. And by the way, that bubble that burst, pay attention to downtown Chicago. Pay attention to what's going to happen when those 8,000 units that are coming on maybe don't get filled up and you have the same problems again. So that's one thing, is to admit we have a problem and we have to figure out how to solve it, and we can't develop our way out of it. So what are we doing about it? We give out information. I think the other thing I want to say, even though academics don't seem to have a lot of impact, I was with about 9,000 geographers the other day, and they seem to think they have impact, but I think they're just ironic sometimes. But we were sitting there talking about what we do, our research around public housing, that's my area primarily, and raising awareness about the fact that actually academics shape a lot of policy. And I don't want to call anyone out, but if you read like the Urban Institute, which is a think tank out of DC, they influence and have shaped what happened to public housing in Chicago, what's happened to public housing around the country, because they have promoted ideas like mixed income housing as solutions to the poverty problem, which we can have long discussions about, or you can read my book, that's just called Where Poor People to Live. So the last thing actually the good thing about that book is we wrote it with a lot of different people, including public housing residents. And it came from their, from advocacy around their work and working with public housing residents. So the last thing I want to say is, I think the big problem that we're not paying attention to, and we're trying to help raise awareness, people have been talking about it, is this reference to A Tale of Two Cities in Chicago. In the United States, growing inequality is huge. And I think it's tied clearly to housing issues that we have to pay attention to. So just a little fact, because I'm a data wonk. Chicago is number 8 in terms of housing, in terms of income inequality. Like New York and Atlanta's number 1, and it's based on the gap between the richest 5% and the poorest 20%. Okay, so the 20% are, you know, what they're. So the 5%, top 5% earn over $200,000 annually, and the bottom 20% earn less than $17,000. Okay?
Here in Chicago.
In Chicago. It's 12 times the difference. So just think about that. What and spatially, we have maps. You can get a, we have a blog about that called, if you just do the deepening divide or get to our website, VoorheesCenter.com. You can see this mapped out and you can see how it's changed over time. So when Mr. Voorhees was concerned about this in 1970, he was talking about a time that was much better. It was the best of times, and now I'm feeling the worst of times, to use the Tale of Two Cities reference. And where is it going? I mean, this the world is looking at income inequality as something that we can't grow ourselves out of the way we have been in the past, and that we, if we don't deal with it, we're going to be worse off. And that's, I mean, we're using language now to describe urban areas in the United States, like Chicago, that we usually use for developing countries. And I think that's something we really have to think about where we're at.
Let me talk a little bit more about, I guess, my background to some degree. I come to this from perhaps a slightly different perspective than some of the other panelists. I've had a couple of lives involving conversations around affordable housing. Prior to coming to the National Public Housing Museum, I was with the Neighborhood Housing Services out in North Lawndale. And some of you might know that neighborhood, but that neighborhood helped me come to think in some very, very critical ways about how we think about housing in this country. And one of the things that Janet just said, not that I would disagree with what Janet said, but sort of using that metaphor, the best of times and the worst of times, from the perspective from which I come, I'm not sure when there were times that were better.
Yeah.
Right? And so you can clearly make that argument very, very easily. Right, so thinking about one, you know, so for perhaps the original sin of the U.S. when you start thinking about race and the impact that that has on how we think about public policy, how we see public policy, how we have thought about housing patterns, for instance, and so thinking about something that that was talked about earlier, let's say something like the GI Bill. Right, and so as an African American, my father could not have taken advantage of that particular program, primarily because he was African American. Right, and so we saw all sorts of impacts on housing and segregation of communities as a result of those kinds of larger public policies that were out there. And so the Lawndale piece was interesting for me because I didn't grow up in Chicago, but I've been living in Chicago for quite some time, and one of the things that came to me quite clearly when I moved to North Lawndale and started working out there was the extent to which the local landscape, the housing patterns, the housing structure, people's attitudes had been shaped by policies like the inability of African Americans to get mortgages from banks. Right, some of you would know about that, others may not. I mean, in a sense, it hasn't been that long ago that an African American could go to a bank in Chicago or Atlanta or Detroit or New York, and you just simply could not get a mortgage from a bank because you were deemed to live in an area that was somehow, you know, difficult or troubled. Right, because we had drawn red lines around those neighborhoods, and banks would make a very calculated decision, a business model decision, that it's too risky to lend in that particular area. But then when you think about all of the policies that resulted in that area being too risky, for instance, think about Chicago. African Americans coming to Chicago in the early 1900s were restricted to living in very, very specific places. Right? And so what we've come to think of as the Black Belt, for instance, along what is now King Drive, that was the only place in Chicago that African Americans were allowed to live. And then there were opportunities, presumably, opportunities that began to emerge a little bit later on into the 50s where African Americans could begin to move out into some of the other neighborhoods, like North Lawndale, and buy a house. But of course, you couldn't get a mortgage from a bank. That meant that if you were going to buy the house, you bought it from a seller, which often was a representative of a syndicate that had put together pots of money. I mean, they literally would go to banks and borrow money, and then they would turn around and use that money to entice a white homeowner to sell their property perhaps for $10,000, whatever the fair market value would have been in, say, 1957 for that two flat in North Lawndale or Garfield or any place else in the city. Then the next day, an African American from the South Side who'd been living in an apartment in the Black Belt with three other families whose working and has two or three jobs, he's got to have a home for his family. And so that house now that just sold yesterday for $10,000, the White family sold it for $10,000, took that $10,000, actually $7,500 of it, and went and bought a brand new house in Schaumburg, perhaps. Or pick another suburb.
Skokie.
Right, $7,500 and you bought a new house. The fair market value of the house was $10,000. So you get this guy, this family that comes along the next day, an African-American family, but the price to them is $25,000, as is. Right, the house is already 60 years old, it needs a new furnace, it needs a new roof. Of course, there's no mortgage on the property, so the family's never going to develop any equity in the property. And so what do you think is going to happen in a situation like that? Right, we're going to get an outcome where neighborhoods where African Americans are buying properties like this will begin to spiral down because they just don't have the income to maintain those properties that were already 60 years old. In fact, a neighborhood like Lawndale was even being described as a slum in the 1940s, before African Americans could even begin to live in the neighborhood. So the point of all of this is that the housing story in this country is so incredibly complex. And depending upon where you're standing or where you're sitting, it might be even more complex. Now, my hat today is as the executive director of the National Public Housing Museum. Right? And so what we are up to is to try to get people to think a little bit differently about how we've come to value or not value government's investment in human capital. And that might even be housing. Right? Because when you think about the 1930s, we made a significant commitment as a nation to take care of people who could not fend for themselves in the marketplace. Right, we're going to produce some housing. And we did that. One of the ironies, though, is that African Americans couldn't live in that public housing. So there's always that sort of hanging out there, the specter of that that's hanging over our housing policies. But public housing was designed to help families move up, right, to somehow get to that American dream. And of course, families who were in public housing had incomes and could work and all of that. And so public housing was quite a different animal than it ended up being in 1995. In fact, I grew up in public housing in Georgia, in rural public housing in Georgia, and I often tell this story, and I'm sure my staff back there is saying, okay, he's gonna tell the story again. But my closest friends in public housing in 1965 in rural Georgia, there was a family of 8 kids. 6 boys and 2 girls. The oldest son was a city councilman for a number of years. Second son drove a MARTA train in Atlanta for 30 years. Third son was a Delta management guy for 30 years. Fourth son, who is my cohort, is an attorney in Atlanta. And of course, his son is in law school now at Pitt, I believe. Fifth son had a military career and taught a number of years at a historically black college in Alabama. 6th son actually taught at Georgia Tech for a number of years. Both daughters were public school teachers. This was a public housing outcome, right, in the 1960s. And then there was my family. We weren't too shabby either. So there was real value in that experience for us as a country. And so one of the things that I would like to see is for us to kind of figure out how we get back there. So one of the biggest issues that we're confronted with now is this issue of perception. Right, what people think about something like public housing. Right, a book recently came out by Larry Vail, and whom else was involved in that? Nick Bloom, Public Housing Myths. And of course, they were here last week and talking about their work, the myths of public housing. Of course, one of those myths was that public housing was a failure. Well, I would submit that the experience that I had and that my friends had, my cohorts had, was not a failure. What failed is the country in terms of how we began to think about public policy and changing our minds, really, about that investment that we're making in people. And of course, most of us can figure the date that that began to happen and the language that was being used, right, to sort of demonize people who were living in public housing. Right? And of course, it was downhill from that point on. That's a fact, we know that. Right? But what we're trying to do with the National Public Housing Museum is to demystify those myths, right, that public housing was a failure, that the architecture of it somehow contributed to the dysfunction of it, that public housing is solely for poor black people. So that's where we're coming from, that's where I'm coming from, and I hope you have some interesting questions about that, and I'm gonna pass this mic on to Frank.
Good evening. Roberta, thank you for the invitation, I appreciate that. I'm not used to using microphone. As a loudmouth lawyer, I'm accustomed to projecting on my own, but I'll use the mic. It's been a long day, as Janet said. You know, it's hard to disagree with anything that I've heard here today. Maybe I'll add just a couple of quick comments, because I think we have a second question Roberta wants to ask us all. I have spent the better part of 34 years working with low-income people and families and homeless people in the small cities of Ohio, amongst the lily-white Christian conservative counties of rural Ohio, and for the last 10 years here in Chicago. The work that I do in representing tenants and consumers, boy do I hate that term, I am not a consumer, I'm not a human resource, leads me every day, 60 hours a week for 34 years, of putting band-aids on the problems that capitalism creates. Those that con you into thinking that somehow these are the interpersonal decisions of these individuals, while ignoring the context in which they arise and are perpetuated. And that has gotten nothing but worse. I spend my life putting band-aids on situations, but that work has led me to the conclusion that the system itself is broken. And without a system change, HUD and its governmental supports will be a failure. And everything that we do inevitably may be a failure. We need a radical redesign of the way that we think about ourselves as a people. Dare I say, we the people. My office is Lawyers Committee for Better Housing. We're a small nonprofit organization that is the only organization in town that's dedicated exclusively to tenants' rights. Tenants, the bottom of the barrel. Certainly in the court system. The prejudice amongst our democratically elected democratic judges, the prejudice against tenants is tremendous. It is a fundamental assumption that tenants have bad intentions. We do a lot of different things in our office. We do a lot of eviction defense work. We also go around organizing buildings of tenants whose landlords have permitted the properties to be dilapidated. In fact, Michael here at our office, raise your hand, Michael. He just came from organizing a building of tenants in Humboldt Park that is the front and center battle of gentrification in our city. We also do policy work. We write position papers and generate data. We also do lobbying and passage of legislation. We've passed a number of city ordinances in Chicago that, surprise, surprise, Mayor 1% went along with us about. We're more surprised than anyone, happily so. The work that I do is I lead a unit of people that represents only tenants who live in buildings that have been foreclosed on. This is obviously the creature of the foreclosure so-called crisis. So my particular role in that is I sue banks on behalf of buildings of tenants when the banks behave utterly illegally and irresponsibly toward buildings full of tenants. Most of them are lower income, but not all. Many of them are minorities, particularly Spanish-speaking people in Albany Park, our northern neighborhoods, African-Americans on the south side, though not exclusively so. I just want to say that the housing crisis, there's no recovery. I don't know who thinks that. Probably the people that report for public radio think that. There's no recovery marketplace. The tenants, just to throw around some numbers, since 2008 through 2014, almost 70,000 rental units were the subject of foreclosure in the city of Chicago alone. 70,000. Not all of those buildings wound up to be abandoned, but a nice clip of about 3,500 tenants that live in foreclosed buildings were the subject of eviction cases post-foreclosure. That's just the tip of the iceberg, because 3 to 4 times that many were scared out of their houses and intimidated out of their homes, or utterly neglected out of their homes. We have some relatively new legislation in the city. It's being hotly contested in the courts by the banks that try to do something about that massive abandonment that's going on in our neighborhoods as a result of boarded up properties from foreclosure. I do want to say that the crisis is far from over for tenants, but you know, we shouldn't be talking. We in America have a shocking lack of history. You know, the Housing Act of 1949 was the product of labor riots all over the United States, serious riots. I don't know, maybe things can change without force. I certainly believe they can. But the housing crisis in my short lifetime this is the fourth time around the block. When I first became an advocate in 1981, we were dealing with the mortgage crisis in Ohio, and we had to organize moratoriums against mortgage foreclosure cases using those dirty scoundrel outsider banks. Well, okay, use the tools you can. Then in the 90s, we were dealing with the predatory lending crisis, where mostly low-income people were being taken advantage of in the kind of mortgage loans they were getting, and redlining, et cetera. Turns out, for those of you that grew up in cities, it was an equal opportunity discrimination, because low-income people in white rural America were getting the same treatment. They, too, had payday lending shops on every corner. So I think what this tells me is that all this work in the trenches of putting Band-Aids on things leads me to one striking conclusion that I think we are at a critical juncture as a country and as a planet. I think that climate change and globalization will perforce compel us to certain decisions if we don't take them ourselves. And to me, this means the relocalization of economies, the humanization of our landscape, and realizing that some of the fundamental things that have been allowed to run wild in this country since Ronald Reagan was president need to be not reversed. I don't revere the past. The past sucked in its own way. And it had great things. Those of you who are Jewish, you know about the Reconstructionist movement. We should learn the good things from the past and reconstitute them in a contemporary context. But there's no admiring the past for the sake of itself. We need to reconstitute our democracy, and people matter. And who is this city for? Is it for the 1%, or is it for the people that live here? Does living in a global city really make any sense if it's going to cause the collapse of everything that we deem to be sacred? Taking responsibility and living where we are with neighborhood connections that includes the housing piece. Housing is not an isolated thing. We will never deal with the housing crisis in any form if we continue to talk about it as though it's a thing unto itself. It is not. It is a breathing part of a living organism that is interconnected. It's interconnected with the food system and how we deliver organic food in this country, where that food is grown, and how we honor the farmers that grow it or don't. So I think that revising our neighborhoods and dealing with the housing crisis in light of climate change and in light of globalization means taking democratic control over where we live in this place and building a humane society that nurtures people.
So how do we democratize our lives? We know our democracy is failing in many ways. I don't know about you, but I feel like I go and vote because I feel responsible to vote, but I really feel like large corporations control this country because they control the money that goes to the people who we're electing. And how does someone who isn't connected to money, who may actually be a very powerful voice, have their voice heard? So it is connected to everything. So we're hearing a lot of difficult stuff tonight. And we could all go home and sort of say, this all sucks, and it's so gigantic. It is just so gigantic. What the hell do we do about it? I truly believe that there is something we can do about it, but you're not here to hear me tonight. You're actually here to hear the panelists. I may add my two cents in at the end, depending upon what people say. But I have such respect for these folks that I think we're going to have some really important things said tonight.
We're in a unique time. I think I'm not a native Chicagoan, I'm a native Clevelander. I've been here for 3 years. As a new Chicagoan, I think there was some history made in this past election in terms of runoffs, in terms of aldermanic runoffs, in terms of a mayoral runoff. And so I think it's worth noting that despite the somewhat depressing feeling at times, that change is being made on the ground, right? And on the northwest side where we're located, only one of our aldermen did not face a runoff. So we had 7 runoffs on the northwest side. And so that told us a lot about our voice and about people and about the way that we were governed. So I think there's hope. So I'll say that. But on the solutions, though we provide the service that I talked about in terms of housing counseling, we're also a community organizing agency. And so what that means is our mission is to engage, educate, and empower the community. And that last word, empower, is to build power. And so as an organization, we build power through people and through money. And so we're never going to have the money that the banks have or the corporations have or our government has. But what we have is the people. And so our job is to build people. And so when I look out in this room, I look at 30-some people. And so all of you have a voice and have power. And so I'm wondering, all of you made a choice to be here tonight and be a part of this discussion in this moment. So what else are you willing to be a part of, right? And so I think this is just the beginning for some of you. Some of you are already involved in our organization, board members, funders, consultants. But I have my business cards here, and if I was a better organizer, I'd already have like a sign-in sheet.
Yeah.
But I have business cards, and so I'd love to pass these out, and anyone that's interested in learning more about what we do and being involved and helping out in any way, we'll take it. It could be calling homeowners, it could be coming to meetings, it could be helping us. We do direct action organizing, so our history is meeting the banks at their branches, going to a bank branch downtown or in one of the neighborhoods when the banks aren't listening to us. We have an 81% success rate in helping homeowners save their home. It's the highest in the state. It's 4 times the average. So thank you. I don't say that to brag. I say it is because we organize, right? And so if a bank's not working with us or dealing with homeowners, we'll load up a school bus and go to that bank branch until we get someone with decision-making authority who's willing to meet with us and address the homeowners. So when we did that with Bank of America, all 55 homeowners with Bank of America loans had loan modifications. And so I think that really is the only way that things are going to change. And so to be as unpolitical as possible, I think we have to organize ourselves. And so it's not Democrat in the big D, it's Democrat in the little D, if I am correct. And so I think we as a group have to think about how we can support each other and build that power at a grassroots level. So.
If I may, I'd like to add something that you probably don't, you may know, but the people that we interviewed that have worked with your organization and have been helped by your organization have all said they felt empowered and they are going to continue doing the work. So not only did they get their own mortgage modifications, but they are likely to go on and organize in their community, and they are organizing around other issues which I gather become very important. So that this grassroots democracy really is very powerful.
Yes, I think that's probably a great way to end. And so, I listen to the stories of Ernie and Nancy and Carlos and Hilda and Phyllis. They're 3 examples of homeowners. Ernie and Nancy and Carlos and Hilda have been doing this for 7 years. That's 4 years longer than I have. And I get paid to do this work. They volunteer on their time outside of their day jobs because they believe in it. And so we're successful because of them. And so I think that's worth noting. And worth saying, and so I appreciate that.
I will just reiterate what I said. That's the mission of the Rehab Network, is to support local organizations that are involved with community building and recognizing that we can't do community building unless there's a place for people to live. And that's a real fundamental issue today is, well, we want to build mixed income communities, and that's a good thing, but if we're not thinking about who really is a part of that? Is there a inclusive agenda to begin with? And all the things that we recognize is one of the things that we're very big with is making sure the policies are in place and resources are in place to do this. So when Frank was talking about the crisis in the rental housing, that was real. And that was one of the reasons we passed a decade ago a resource in the state of Illinois. It's called the Illinois Donation Tax Credit. And it's a real important tool. It's virtually used in every development of affordable housing today. And it's under renewal right now. So picking up on James' thing, you're welcome to call your senators or your representatives and say, we really want to see the donation tax credit continued. Because the only way it would pass is if there was a sunset on it. Because people didn't want it to go on forever. So now it's sunsetting. And Rahner's administration is, as you all know, looking at what is every possible hit on the general revenue fund. And our effort is to say, well, look, yes, there is a hit to it, but more importantly, it's leveraging 2-to-1 resources so that there's housing. And we saw the same thing working with people across the city about the affordable requirements ordinance. That's another policy. So the piece here is, I would be remiss not to back up what Charles has said. I certainly had no education and awareness to the level. I also am a fellow Buckeye living in Chicago. So there's all this history. But
how'd you do this, Roberta?
We're also the outsider here.
But it is an incredible story, the story of race in housing. And I used to say, and still say, that if you want to know who we are in America, since there's this issue about democratization and returning or finding what it looks like in the future, is I used to tell folks, boy, if you read the history of public education in America, it's just fascinating narrative about where we've come and different people's perspectives on it. And if you overlap that with housing, you really have something about things that matter, because we have to have a place, and it starts at home. So that's why we're about making sure the resources and policies, that's the solution, and you have to ask our questions. If there is an infrastructure trust in the city of Chicago, we ask, well, how are they helping do something about housing? If there's a casino there, and they're going to be bringing in all these resources and taxes, I have to ask the question. Even though my friends on the left are saying, don't you dare ask that question, it's just bad. But I'm asking the question, if you're bringing in new resources to the city, what are you doing to make sure it's hitting those households who are in limited fixed income? So it's a whole range of policies and resources with a mind to preserving what we have and making sure we think about who's being served with these policies.
Okay, I felt like bringing some props. I'm getting rid of my Band-Aids. I'm going to change the elections next time. Chewy almost won. By the way, he was my master's student. I did no harm, the first rule of urban planning. And the only union button I could find was my one faculty, which is actually a big push right now, unionizing. I'm president of the faculty union at UIC. And we've been talking about unions being about democracy. It's not about this, you know, right to work that comes out of Bruce Rauner's mouth. It's not, that's really clever advertising, by the way. It's really about democracy, and I think that's why I wanted to put those out there and get rid of the Band-Aid, although I'm gonna keep it because I have a blister. But I think that you've heard already, and it's, Frank's a tough act to follow in terms of the radical thinking, and sometimes radical though means returning to your roots, so I wanna be careful which roots we go back to. But if you wanna go back to like Rousseau, who made the quote about like whoever put down the first stakes and called this land mine, maybe we should go back to that time in the 1700s, the birth of inequality, as he talked about it. I would think that's a good route to go back to, actually. I also want to then fast forward to now in time and sort of talk about real things. Some things to follow up on what Kevin was talking about, and really I'm just piggybacking on work that other groups are doing, including the Rehab Network, which is a vigilante, if you will, watching quarterly what the city of Chicago is doing or not doing with its money. You know, we claim poverty a lot of times in the city, and that's really a lie. It's mismanagement, misuse of money, I would argue, and especially when it comes to affordable housing. I don't know what the dollar amount is now, but it's probably just cha-ching, 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 because we're building all this high-end housing. The Affordable Requirements Act, or Ordinance, ARO, that just passed with revisions, has in its pot, last I heard, was $53 million sitting there.
63. It's over that, because that was just
That was in the end of December.
Three months, the quarter.
3 months, it gained $10 million.
That's a
cha-ching, 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 right? It's a lot of development because it's attached to the high-end housing. Now that's money that could be used now to build housing. So keep that. I got a bigger number though, bigger number. Chicago Housing Authority. You know how much they have sitting there that they're not spending? $440 million. Cha-ching, cha-ching, cha-ching. We could build a lot of housing with that right now. But you know what they're doing instead? They're paying down their, they're using it for pensions. Oh yeah, that's good. Okay, so then the other thing that they have sitting there that could help people literally right now, because that money has to be used to build it, they have in their pot probably a worth about, I don't know how much the value is, but it estimates to be between 10 and 13,000 families could be helped now with housing assistance vouchers. So instead of paying more than 30% of their income for rent, they could actually get assistance right now. Okay, so this is the work, good work of organizations like the Chicago Housing Initiative, which has led the charge to push forward with keeping the accountability of the Chicago Housing Authority out there, and they've got, I think, the sign-on now of over 30 aldermen to support this, but it's still not ROM-proof, as they would say. Okay, so that's just there. There's money right there. Obviously, the work that Charles and the museum is doing, how do we work and to preserve affordable housing through public housing preservation? Despite the stories you hear, public housing is not gone. There are residents in public housing fighting the good fight right now, literally holding down roots at Cabrini Green, at Alt Gull Gardens on the far south side. You can look at it, Lathrop Homes, they're in a big fight right now around in historic preservation, all the things that are going on there. And so we have to realize that there are residents fighting every day to keep their housing. And we have to support them. And if you stay in the house, that's a big part of the battle, okay? As soon as you move out, you lose a lot. So we have to think about that. Another thing that I would push, and if you were around last Wednesday when it was a beautiful day and a bunch of our friends marched downtown to McDonald's for the Fight for 15, living wage is really critical. So right now the housing wage in Chicago is $18 an hour. If you earned $18 an hour, you wouldn't be in the statistics that Roberta's talking about. Think about it.
That's to rent a two-bedroom.
Yeah, to rent a two-bedroom apartment. Okay, think about this. If we were to raise minimum wage to $15 an hour, how many more families we would take off that list of not being able to afford their housing, remove a little bit more of their insecurity. It still means that they're not earning enough, believe me, but just think about that. And by the way, the minimum wage is not going up until 2019 to $13 an hour. Do the inflation math, not good. Okay, so the last thing I'm gonna say is more community control. You heard that, local. As a plug, we have developed a gentrification index and toolkit that is available on our website, again, VoorheesCenter.com, one word, VoorheesCenter.com. And if you have some time on Friday and you want to come out, we're having a symposium where we're bringing together, I think we're up to 75, 80 people coming. It's called Taking Control of Our Neighborhood's Future. It's at UIC. All information registration is on our website at VoorheesCenter.com. That toolkit will be handed out. We're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about how we can use it. And I got word today that the other guy who should have won for mayor, in my opinion, is going to show up and give a few brief remarks.
Okay, I'd like to talk about two distinct issues here. First, I'm going to be somewhat provocative. It's been a curious week, I think, certainly for me, but probably for people all around the country in a number of ways. I just want to reference this by saying that there is Baltimore, mm-hmm. right? And so what's happening in Baltimore today? And putting that in some context sort of plays on what Frank was talking about in terms of the riots, right, that led to changes in housing policy. And so then that puts a real interesting question on the table for us, a very provocative question. What does it take to affect change, right? Does it take kids in the street throwing rocks at a mall in Baltimore to finally get the country to pay some attention to this question that we're confronted with about how kids in neighborhoods deal with the police, what those interactions are? Is that what it takes for us to get our attention as a nation? Right, that's a valid question. I think a lot of people are struggling with that this week. And of course, as Frank pointed out, there's some documented history that level of civil disobedience can have some impact on public policy. So I'm not advocating that we all go out and start throwing rocks at banks downtown. But
Marshmallows.
Marshmallows. Well, maybe marshmallows. So just something to think about. Let's, you know, be as provocative about this as we can. Another point that I wanted to make is that a part of my interesting week was today I was at a panel over at UIC that the Great Cities was putting on global cities, and one of our new friends from that discussion is here tonight, Montserrat, and she's from Ecuador. And so a part of the conversation that the Ecuadorians were having with us this morning is how they now are thinking about the broader public policies in Ecuador around questions of social justice, housing, and education. And so the term that they're using to describe the approach, this model that Ecuador is embarking upon, is the good life. Right? And so in terms of the good life, what they seem to be referencing is that they are actually discounting the value of the marketplace and thinking that people's lives are somehow much more important. Well, we have a pretty robust growth rate, economic growth rate in Ecuador right now. I think it was around 4%. But we would trade that off if we needed to figure out strategies for helping more people in our society live the good life. So that's just something that I wanted to reference with our friends from Ecuador. Thank you for that. That was very, very enlightening this morning. And now, interestingly, they are very interested in our housing policies, particularly sort of social housing policies, public housing policies in general. And so we're a little bit startled when we begin to talk about the way CHA, the Chicago Housing Authority, has embarked upon its strategy over the last decade, the plan for transformation, and so trying to wrap their heads around that and what that means. I won't say much more about that, but just to say that in terms of how we think about finding some strategies to make some improvements, how we make ourselves better and somehow get to the good life. Well, I would indict how we think about planning in general, our public policies. We just don't do that very, very well. We're very short-sighted. You know, and one of the things that we're going to do with the National Public Housing Museum this year is to sort of take our show on the road, and we're going to go down to New Orleans. This is the 10th anniversary of Katrina, right? And so a lot of housing was lost in New Orleans during this catastrophe, this disaster. A lot of public housing was lost. And so what I would say about that, though, in some ways, in terms of our lack of planning and sort of rational thinking about what our issues are, is that there's nothing about New Orleans that none of us did not know before Katrina. We knew that New Orleans was literally on shaky ground, that the city is sinking, that the levee system was inadequate. But are we willing to make that kind of investment in our infrastructure that is going to pretend well for us in the long term? We respond to crisis, right? We don't think in terms of what we can do to maintain what we've already have. And so just something to think about, some food for thought. And I think the National Public Housing Museum over the next couple of years is going to spend a lot of time looking at these kinds of questions of how we think about doing some rational planning and when it comes to looking at public housing, how we continue to push the envelope on making certain that we don't lose this kind of commitment that we've made as a nation to investing in our human infrastructure.
What I'm encouraged to hear is that all of these people that are in the trenches are optimistic. None of them are cynical. They all believe that things can and must change. In fact, I would say that change is in the very nature of our species, even as biological organisms. There's very few things that we know for sure, but one thing we know for sure is change. Those in power would have us believe that what exists now has always been and always must be. But in my short lifespan, the universe has changed a great deal. God, remember your high school civics teacher that trots out the pictures of, you know, the horse-drawn trolley cars from the 1890s, and then they hold up their smartphone or something. You know, I mean, things are going to be different. The question is who's going to control the change, and what is that change going to be about? Not whether it's going to change. Though I believe that our fundamental system of our plutocracy and our capitalist system have failed us, nevertheless, I take great pleasure in small gains, and I think we all must. I think we build on small accomplishments. For small accomplishments to add up to something under the time constraints of climate change, 10 years, it has to be more focused and there has to be a grander vision of we the people, which is where our political leaders and our media, I lay a lot of blame for this on the media, our political leaders and our media have a lack of vision. What's that? Prophet Amos said, the people perish for want of vision. There needs to be a vision out there so that these small gains have a target, so that they add up to something, not just the poor demanding more band-aids from the rich who have a vested interest in making everybody poorer. Please give me my $13 an hour so I can continue to consume my electronic gadgets. I mean, there needs to be a rethinking. I think that there are some optimistic things on the front. So what would I do over the next 5 years alone? There's two ordinances in Chicago that are relatively new, the Keep Chicago Renting Ordinance, that forces big financial institutions to keep properties active and avoid abandoning them. When I speak in too many neighborhoods in Chicago, I say, raise your hand if you have at least one boarded up building on your block, not your neighborhood, your block. And everybody raises their hand. I say, put your hand down if there's only two. Put your hand down if there's only three. And to get all those hands down, you gotta get to four. Wow, okay, so that ordinance plus the vacant property ordinance are two powerful tools in Chicago that if we take advantage of them in a coordinated way under a grander vision can have a lot of mileage. Second thing that we need to do is in 1997, our Democratic, big D, Democratic legislature in Springfield passed an anti-rent control ordinance that prohibits local municipalities from engaging in rent control activities. That needs to be repealed. If you think we can fight gentrification, and by gentrification I don't mean well-intentioned people fixing up dilapidated properties, I don't mean that. I mean the utter displacement of communities and cultures so that the wealthy can move into them because it's cachet of some sort. Not every place needs a granite countertop, I'm sorry. So that needs to be repealed so that we can enact rent control in Chicago. Another thing that needs to happen is there are two interesting developments, both at the county and city level, and now at a couple of nonprofit organizations, including the Albany Park Neighborhood Association and Central Autonomo in the Niles side in the Albany Park areas, land trusts and land banks, where properties are donated or purchased, more often than not purchased, so that they can be put to productive use in the community. I'm not big on land banks, but that's just making rich white folks continue to be rich white folks. I am enthused, though, about a land trust that puts the property in the hands of nonprofit organizations that help build communities. Frequently, they are buying the properties at market rates or near market rates. So this is not like donations out of someone's charity or anything like that. So we need to grow those things, and we need to leverage people in the community to continue to let those things grow. I think we should leverage CHA through our political and elected officials. CHA is a public body subject to the Freedom of Information Act and Sunshine Laws. We should leverage them to use some of this money to set up a demonstration project to have co-housing in Chicago. This idea of self-sufficiency from Ronald Reagan, that somehow just the nuclear family must be completely independent from the rest of the world, is an obscene idea in human history and across human culture. I would never quote Hillary Clinton or her stuff about villages. She means the planet, which is weird. But you know, I mean, we as a species is an interconnected sense. We derive our meaning from our interconnection with others. And when we have an infatuation as a matter of public policy with the nuclear family, not even the extended family, we become isolated. And so levels of depression and hopelessness and lack of political involvement stem in part from that. We can live in co-housing arrangements. We have the land in Chicago because of the foreclosure, abandoned properties have been knocked down. We got all this land. public housing complexes sit on a bunch of land. I represented the tenants in Robert Taylor Homes, and I represent the tenants at Old Guild Gardens that are sitting on a mound of land. Well, why can't we devise co-housing networks with Waldorf Education for the preschool program? And why can't we make an arrangement with the emerging under 30 organic urban farming network in Chicago? Peel away the veneer. That is a growing movement by leaps and bounds. Why can't we make contracts with organic farmers around Illinois, and there's plenty of them, to re-energize our economy, take control over it locally so we're not dependent on the whims of globalization, and re-energize our democracy? Because to do that, you gotta turn off the TV and go outside and dig in the grass with your kids and with your neighbors. So I think we can have public housing demonstration projects make all these links and connections to show people that this stuff can work. And the nice thing about it is, we're not inventing anything. All this stuff is happening at various places around the country and to some extent around the world, whether it's in Ecuador or Gaviotas in Colombia or wherever it may be. We don't have to invent wheels. We just have to borrow and steal from those things that we know already work.
Because I want to show how making things visible can change the lives of many people. Reverend Hood, could you just take a moment or two?
Everything that they said at this table, and the things that we can approach ourselves to, and James, you said it well, because all of us could do something. I remember years ago when we worked on the set-asides with Kevin. 30% set aside, they ended up being 15%. So came up with something, though it was nothing. And Charles come from my old neighborhood, North Lawndale, so I know some of you all. What I'm thinking today, how we can connect together, one common thread, and then I got to say this about Chuy Garcia. Chuy had to stay with me for a whole week in a Native American reservation. You asked him how I felt staying with Reverend Hood for a whole week with no phones, no TVs, no nothing. So me and Chuy became blood brothers back in some years ago. And yes, he should have won that election. What Roberta was talking about, some of you already know, there is not just one predator, but several predators that have found a way to take seniors' money through reverse mortgages, through scams that's really unbelievable. It's so unbelievable, I told Roberta today, she had a new fan, and she said, who? I said, the FBI. Because the FBI has been watching my work along with the work they've been trying to do, and they wanted to know, how did I end up here? And it excited them. And I believe they're in the room today. If you with the FBI, raise your hand.
They don't tell you.
How many would admit it?
I knew the lawyer was going to say so. But anyway, how this one gentleman did it, he went to senior's house and said that he was working with CETA and can do rehab for free. Now, these were not our ordinary seniors. These were seniors that had suffered, needed work between the ages of 75 and 95 years old, dementia. Really nobody there. The average child was probably 65 to 70 years old. So he was able to target, and I mean, he did a good job for over 30 years. But where he messed up at, he came into our community And North Lawndale, just like in the other community, we tight-knit it. And we were doing summer jobs. And just like any other neighborhood with high-risk youth, the youth was telling me about how this gentleman took their grandmother's house. And I would just holler at him every day, if you will do your work, then we don't have to worry about violence. I said, let's focus on this, and then we can focus on the housing. But what happened at the end of the summer, I found out my aunt had became a victim of this gentleman. And as any good organizer, I did research on this guy had 80 cases going on the federal level where he's been sued, the county level, and his name was in different real estate conversations all over when they talked about predatory, they had him. But he never went to jail, never got caught up on anything. So that makes a person like me quite upset. What I'm here to tell you, in about 7 days, he will be fully indicted for what he did. I know fans call me every day, 8 more days, 7 more days, and that's good. How he did this, again, you know, he said he was rehabbing and is free, sign here, sign there, but he had to have some enablers, right? Goes back to the mortgage company, okay? It goes back to the attorney he was working with. Come to find out, his attorney that's trying to get out of this stuff now, but too late. He's wrapped around. I told him, you wrap around service now. And the attorney, the mortgage company, all of them got to face the feds. Now, this is just one guy. He got over 115 people just in North Lawndale. He got my aunt for about $155,000. But he averaged at about $200,000 to $255,000. Don't finish none of the work. Start everything. You ever had a kid like that always start something, never finish anything? This is the type of guy he was. So you figured if he did this 115 times, that's $20 million. So what happened, Kevin, my organizer, had went on. I seen the HUD complaining about $20 million that they lost in the year 2014. So I called him, I said, I know how we can get $20 million back. How can we do this? I said, meet with me. And I told him, this guy had done this. They said, well, how did you come up with that figure? I said, look at the people. So what ended up happening, the attorney general was able to stop his business. But the US attorney started checking his attorney's bank accounts. Overseas, overshore. The money's somewhere. He did something with 20, you know, you got 115 people at 200,000 a pop. You got some money somewhere. So this is the new wave of predatory lending. Another thing happened in the process, we made so much noise and kept it so much in the media that the senator, Jackie Collison and Patricia Van Pelt, and you remember Patricia, right? You taught her in rehab, housing rehab. They got wind of it. Of course, they got upset with me because I didn't call them. Because sometimes it need to come from where? The grassroots. The seniors needed to do it. And they put together a bill, Senate Bill 1281. This happened, about 6 weeks ago. Today, it passed Finance and the Senate, and going into the House, it will be a law within the next 30 days. The governor will be signing the law. And that's a huge accomplishment from organizing, bringing people together, and giving them, you know, it's embarrassing, especially somebody that owned a house like my aunt since 1971. So all of us together, can you imagine what we can do in such a short period of time just in the state of Illinois alone, just from connecting people to stuff? And, you know, I used to wouldn't go on Facebook. This is my last word. I wouldn't go on Facebook, and I wouldn't. All I would do was email. That was it. But I started Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. That's how the fans got a hold of me. Because I, you know, if you tell me something, I'm going to put exactly what you say. When they say 14 days, I say 14 days to be indicted. They say, Reverend, we just told you that. I said, well, don't tell me. I'm not the one to tell, because everything you tell me, I'm going to tell the community. They said, well, can you tell, put in there that it's going to happen soon? I say, I just got through talking to the feds, it's going to happen soon, 14 days.